sum chơi ông cứ cho ông xin nội dung đây các bản to cách làm là ca để tệ vị thì sạm là ca hay chỉ cách bản to này cứ chỉ làm là ca này ca phơi cái sản là than tôm rồi bỏ phe kỳ vì để vì làm nàng đào mà đang gặp vị ní nâng rư đầm nà thạ pri nhà rô sân bờ miền vận tài đầm bay ở bàn sụp bạc lo nâng tầm rộp tầm rùl cách tầm nà ca đi rô bật tới bàn là ó ông dìm ra xong thua ca rùm lực đò phía kỳ tầng ó thà nơi phê thua tầy sân thàn tốp trời phát đau từ lời cả bài nhà hát đại chia cả một thụ này cả vị này chay sẽ đầy rồi bỏ ông chân mình ra tại bên nọ phía kia tầng ở trời cửa rộp sứt rồi bỏ phía kia đầu tí nơi bề đại khu này dí rùm tiếng sứt rồi bỏ chân chọc chào phòng đài phía kia tầng ở trời tầm miền ca prong vầy dắt nơi ca bình chánh bịa xâm đấy à cặp kê đầy ra bỏ khu phía kia tầng ơ trai cửa rút nơi crom xa là thoa bởi chia chỉ viện rồi bọc luôn ông nhìn ra thằng khâm tha phía kia tầng ơ nâng để dì tại sống an hết tầng lai ná đã tiện tình từ nâng ông hết phó tàng nâng ông chấp bắp nâng mình để dì cho đồng đài từ lưu sạc đây sẵn là thang đau rồi bọc luôn lời lưu phí ní tự tiết phía kia tầng ơ nâng cửa rút bởi lý đài ông chung nhìn ra bán tầm rạch rụi hời chia cả nó vắt đảm bay oi miên và sân tập hiếp nơi sạc đây này nôm ni ông nhầm ra xông nhầm riêp thá nâng cắt bắt đạch nơi sạc đây thân thân tộp ná đây là mình trộm nâng ca này nôm ni đôi đầm bốn ông nhầm ra nâng rầm lực đọt phía ký na đầy miên bánh nhá nâng bằng tộp mộc nâng cắt bắt đạch nơi sạc đây sân thân tộp nụ bằng chúc lấy ao chơi tại thanh thanh tôm tại mà đòn chiếc kịch bản to này cứ ta khang về vì đồng nàng đang mà đang gặp đạo vị ní miền tại phơi tại thanh thanh tôm tại nâng tại thanh thanh rồi bỏ chuẩn chọc chào nâng mẹ tử vi ca phía cái đây đại đệ tí hay ông nhầm rác xong nhầm riêp thá mẹ tử vi đâm nàng đang mà đang rọt bằng đi chăng buôn cớm miên bê bê lia xa rốc chùm nuôn mùi màu nâng nông cá phước đế sân thán là tốm đi
Mr. President, I'm grateful that all four civil parties, intend to make submissions in rebuttal within the 1 hour that's been allotted.
With Mr. President, your leave,
I will start first. I have been allotted 20 minutes, 5 minutes have been given by civil party group number 4. Mr. President, your leave, I would ask to proceed.
Mr.
President,
I'm most grateful. Mr. President, Your Honours, respected counsel for the defence, learned prosecutors, and my fellow lawyers for the civil parties, as well as, of course, the members of the public and the people of Cambodia who have taken the time out of their busy schedule to listen to these final remarks. It is a long path
វា គឺ ជា ផ្លូវ
មួយ
ដ៏ វែង ឆ្ងាយ
walked
ដែល យើង បាន ធ្វើ ដំណើរ មក រួម គ្នា ទាំង អស់
since any survivor left S21
ចាប់ តាំង ពី អ្នក ដែល រស់ រៀន មាន ជីវិត ចាក់ ចេញ ពី មន្ទីរ ស-21
And it is at the end of this road that it is hoped that justice will be obtained. But Your Honours, before I go into the substance of my rebuttal, I think it's only fair with your leave to acknowledge, as it is my learned friend Mr. Roos' last occasion in robes, the elegant and useful submissions that he has made throughout these proceedings. That he has, if I may say so, and I believe it's a sentiment shared by all civil parties, brought a great deal of wealth, experience, charm, as well as ability to the conduct of his difficult task. Your Honour, there will not be any philosophy from me, nor will my submissions be anywhere near as erudite as the submissions put forward by Mr. Roos. My task, Your Honours, is to seek to focus on some evidence that may assist Your Honours in determining the truth, so that the claims of my civil parties can be once and for all finally, fully, and properly determined. Your Honour, it is of course a singular honour and a right of course of the accused to be represented by the most able of counsel. That right has been granted him. But the focus of these proceedings is on the conduct, the character, the evidence, and the guilt or otherwise of the gentleman that sits in the dock at the moment. Now, Your Honours, there's no soft way to put this. It is my respectful submission that the accused in this case has sought to ride two horses. The events of yesterday cannot be easily swept under the carpet. At the last possible moment, as Mr. Roos said, yesterday things changed. They did indeed. Because in place of what was viewed as a guilty plea in material respects, we heard that in fact the accused is seeking to be let free. He is complaining about the very fact of prosecution against him. Your Honour, there are two completely different positions being put forward by the defence that sits opposite. This is unfair. This is unfair to the people of Cambodia, it is unfair to the victims, and it is unfair to Your Honour's search for the truth. Your Honour, there is no provision similar to Rule 71 dealing with notice disagreements between defence counsel. Your Honour, that may be for a number of reasons, but perhaps one of them is this: that as opposed to the co-prosecutors, the co-defence counsel have a client, and the client can give instructions. And it is by that mechanism that inconsistencies and friction and completely contradictory accounts can be reconciled should the accused wish such reconciliation to take place. Now, my learned friend stated that he didn't wish to belabor the bench with a detailed final brief. It was indeed scant in my respectful submission. 16 pages after a trial of 19 months perhaps did not help focus the minds of the defence. But Your Honours, be that as it may, the result of all of this is that for the first time the civil party that I represent is being faced with a fundamentally different position and has 15 or 20 minutes to respond to it. That is unnecessary. And indeed, however unfortunate it may be, Whatever the reasons behind it, it also has an aspect that could well amount to an abusive process. Now, Your Honour, my learned friend, Mr. Roo, with his usual charm and verve, mentioned that the prosecutor, the co-prosecutors, had lost their date with history. Co-prosecutors, of course, will speak for themselves. And I say this in sorrow more than anger. It is my respectful submission that the accused has missed an important opportunity to actually speak clearly, unequivocally, spontaneously, candidly,
to the court.
Your Honour's disregarding, it seems, the invitation that was put forward by the prosecution to freely and openly accept that not only was he de jure, the legal head of S21, but also that he freely and voluntarily participated in that mean regime. The accused, you may have noticed, physically turned away during important parts of the submission of the co-prosecutor and turned and intently looked to the right. Instead of responding to the views, the concerns, the pain and the plight of the civil parties, the accused embarked upon what I call a carefully scripted, carefully constructed, paragraph by paragraph, footnote by footnote, statement, perhaps choreographed, carefully constructed in any event. The accused himself said yesterday, and of course I haven't had the benefit of a transcript, and I stand to be corrected, but Your Honour, I believe he was describing an incident when he was investigating an alleged shooting, and he looked at a mosquito net that had a bullet hole in it. And in the course of this inquiry, he had caused to speak to the suspect. And the accused stated, well, in the course of that, from the demeanour and the face of the suspect, I could make certain assumptions as to whether or not the truth was being told. Well, Your Honour, if that is correct and the accused has that ability, it is certainly my respectful submission, well within the province of Your Honour's experience, after having gauged the demeanour of this witness these last 7 months, and after reviewing all the evidence, to make an objective and dispassionate assessment as to his genuineness of remorse and his sincerity or otherwise. Your Honour, contrition is valuable for the civil parties I represent. Sincerity is valuable. And a full and frank account of the truth is priceless. Indeed, it is the only thing that the gentleman in the dock can offer those civil parties. Those civil parties whose lives have been torn, shattered, and smashed because of the regime that he operated in S21 all those years ago. Now, my learned friend, Mr. Roo, in an impassioned statement, stated, well, who can dispute tears? But Your Honour, tears perhaps are not determinative on the issue of contrition or the genuineness of remorse. And I pause there for a moment. My learned friend lifted the veil of legal privilege and sought to give an account of the accused's demeanour in private consultations. Your Honour, it is my respectful submission that the only evidence that you must consider, and my learned friend himself referred to Rule 87, 872 speaks to the issue, the only evidence that is probative and admissible From the evidence that has been tested and passed, the submission of the account of malevolent, whilst riveting, is legally irrelevant. The same applies to his hypothetical, the post-traumatic stress disorder. This is a court of law.
But the objective of the court was to dramatic stress disorder. This is a court of law.
Your Honour, we referred in our opening speech to the statement of Mr. Hamill, but there are many examples. One is the example of Lei Chan, who gave evidence on the 7th of July. And Mr. President, you will remember, because you very correctly, very compassionately, very appropriately asked the witness, would you care to have a moment to compose yourself? And why was the witness? Why was the civil party so distraught? It was something that appears to be quite small at first instance. It was a question as to whether or not he had had a drink of water. And the reason the witness broke down was his pitiful response that he tried as far as possible to desist from taking water because he knew full well that he would be made to drink the urine once it had been digested. In my respectful submission, the number of tears, the number of how many times the accused's eyes welled up can take us only so far. At the end of the day, it is not a matter susceptible to the minds of man to peer into the heart of another individual, to peer into his soul. It is simply not possible. We have heard much of the accused's conversion to Christianity, and in that regard, the well-known Old Testament phrase comes to mind, punishment is mine, saith the Lord.
Your Honour, all of us, and any that believe in a God of that philosophy,
have a belief in a final day of reckoning. But Your Honour, that final day of reckoning is not today. This case calls for a judgment in this world for these crimes and in relation to those matters that Your Honours must seek to discharge your heavy and onerous responsibility, not from some flight of fancy, but by reviewing the evidence and bringing your collective and individual experience to bear.
Your Honour, I am concerned about
Your Honour, there's an awful lot of issues to cover, and I will move as quickly as I can through them. Your Honour, the accused stated yesterday that a decision as to which path to walk is made in a moment, but the repercussions last a long time. Your Honour, it's important to remember that this is not a momentary lapse that's being alleged in this case that had tragic consequences. It is not the case of an individual falling asleep at the wheel and tragically killing a family of young children. The accused, we say, in the 3 years and 5 months of SX21's existence, have the opportunity every day to make a decision. In relation to each of the 12,380 victims, there were 12,380 moments when the accused could have done the right thing. And you're honest, confronted with the massive evidence that are the archives of S21, we say that the accused, as in evidence yesterday, has been content to leave matters opaque, contradictory, and ambiguous. Your Honour, the issues of yesterday and the submissions of my learned friend Carl can be dealt with quite briefly, I hope. On the statute of limitation point, I don't have time to address you, but we will rest on the submissions we filed on the 18th of May 2009. For the reasons detailed therein, we say that the position of the defence is fundamentally misconceived. In relation to the plea ratio materia, the lack of personal jurisdiction because the accused is said not to bear the greatest responsibility, to not be one of those most responsible, I can't help but allude to Rule 89 that preliminary objections should ordinarily be made 30 days after closing order. But, Your Honour, be that as it may, there's an awful lot of case law showing that the accused cannot avail himself of any plea in that regard.
Your
Honour, the accused has stated through his counsel yesterday that he's a victim of the court as merely he's a loyal servant. Your Honour, it's very difficult to reconcile that with the requirement of the victims to get justice. Your Honour, there's many, many examples one can refer to, but I don't have time. Your Honour, Milosevic was referred to. On that regard, I will simply note that this is the first trial here. The first trial in the ICTY was Tadic, who was simply a camp guard, and the ICTY, a forum that the national co-lawyer for the accused seems to support, clearly thought they had jurisdiction in relation to that case for an accused lacking far more, having far less responsibility. My learned friend Mr. Roo stated that the accused never sought to blame his subordinates. Well, yesterday his co-national lawyer stated that Hoare and the guards were responsible, not the accused. Your Honour, nothing could be more in conflict than that. It said that the accused has no autonomy. And I would refer simply to the 6th of August 2009 transcript, where Mr. Roo talked about Mr. Chandler being a capital witness. And rather, Mr. Chandler himself stated he didn't believe the accused in relation to lack of autonomy. He simply didn't believe him. Your Honour, a lot has been said on JCE. I would simply make the observation in the time I've got left that one case that hasn't been cited by the prosecution at all, and in part this underpinned my own position, is the ICTR case of Saromba, the 12th of March 2008. The spelling has been given to the stenographers. And there the appeals chamber stated that it is irrelevant that the accused did not personally drive the bulldozer that destroyed the church. What is important is that he fully exercised his influence over the bulldozer driver, who, as the trial chamber's findings demonstrate, accepted him as the only authority. And in that case, the appeals chamber of the ICTR found the accused guilty of committing. Your Honour, the defence has sought to make a lot of play about the fact that the accused didn't actually have blood on his hands and could not be found guilty of commission. This authority, my submission, makes it clear that one can be found guilty under the jurisprudence of the ICTR for committing in materially identical circumstances as that alleged in relation to the accused. Your Honour, 30 years after the events, our civil parties want the truth. They want their lives back. They want some kind of closure. And it is simply unacceptable from every angle that we are left in this chaotic state of affairs where we do not know actually what is being said. Mr. Roo states that the accused is not pleading guilty, but he's not pleading guilty. but he's accepting contrition. His co-national lawyer says release him. He's absolutely not guilty. This is not an Albert Speer case. This is a unique case that can be described by many adjectives. But I will simply say highly unacceptable and absolutely avoidable. Your Honour, truth and justice are beyond value. It's the minimum the people of Cambodia deserve. It's the minimum my civil parties deserve. And Your Honour, we have every confidence that you will be alive to your task. You will approach it with diligence and care and attention. And Your Honour, I'm most grateful for your time.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Mr. President. Good afternoon, Your Honour. I will speak on behalf of Group 2. Unfortunately, my Cambodian colleague has been worried so that Mr. Khmer says that I will speak alone for Group 2 today. Thank you, Mr. President. The closing
statement of the National Defense Lawyer
ពិសាដេញដល់របស់មេធាវីការពីក្តីដែលថាមិនមានការសារភាពចំពោះពីរដ្ឋាភិបាលនេះយើងមិនជឿតល់តែសោះចំពោះជនជាប់ចោទដែលគាត់បានហាក់ដូចជាបានទះកំភ្លៀងតាមម្ដងរដ្ឋបព្វវេននេះ
I would like to go now to the Honorable Minister. So what I raised was not a challenge to jurisdiction. I only wanted the court to follow the rule 98.7 regarding the jurisdiction of the court over my client, because if he is not the most senior person or most responsible person to be prosecuted, then he should not be prosecuted. I just wanted to confirm his position, and I think they are just my comments for the court consideration. Subsequently, we could simply respond to requesting to reject his objection, as it is not admissible at this stage of the proceedings. In motion. The law on outlawing the Democratic Kampuchea Group does not question the existence of the ECCC law, as it aims, according to the preamble, to prosecute the Khmer Rouge who continued fighting out the elections after 1993, was an attempt to reintegrate them and offer an amnesty. Never ever will the most serious crimes, like crimes against humanity and war crimes, contemplated by this law. Therefore, the ECCC law has its proper jurisdiction, it is neither superfluous nor invalid because of the existence of the outlawing law. The ECCC law targets senior leaders and most responsible and covers only the most serious international crimes. Second, the personal jurisdiction of the ECCC law encompasses senior leaders and most responsible. The accused is, according to the closing order, considered as one of the most responsible. This term is an indefinite legal concept that has to be determined by the office of the co-prosecutors and lies at their discretion. Their determination is not appealable. Criteria for the determination of such a concept are, among others, the number of crimes, the brutality of the acts, the length of the criminal activities, and the extent of power that a person has. The discretion is broad. The accused was under the order and supervision of the Standing Committee, which was the highest body of the Communist Party in Democratic Kampuchea. He allegedly ordered the torture and killing of at least 12,273 registered women and men, being in daily contact with the Standing Committee. Alone, these facts easily allow considering him as somebody who belongs to the most responsible, not a mere, not being a mere instrument. Thirdly, the defense counsel claimed that all other prison chiefs were not prosecuted and therefore the accused does not fall under the personal jurisdiction of the court. The counsel refers to Article 31 of the Constitution of Cambodia, according to which Cambodian people have equal rights. Counsel obviously misunderstands this article, which grants equality in having and getting rights. It does not guarantee a right to, quote, equality in injustice, unquote. This right does simply not exist. In contrary, being in an unjust position, and I add, like the accused is, does not allow to claim And as the Human Rights Committee established under Article 28 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, it has adopted on 23rd August 2004 in the case Dizel against Austria the following. I quote, Article 26 of the Covenant would be unfounded even if the situations were comparable in the absence of a right to, quote, equality in injustice, unquote. According to the Constitutional Court's jurisprudence, the legality of an authority's decision cannot be challenged on the basis of that authority's failure to sanction similar misconduct in comparable cases. Otherwise, any law would invariably be inapplicable and the principles of the rule of law jeopardized. This could not have been the intention of the equality principle in Article 26 of the Covenant. Unquote. To put it simply, the accused cannot claim that he should not be prosecuted because others are not, as a right to equality and injustice does not exist. Fourth, the demand of the National Defense Council to rank the prisons and security centers of Democratic Cambodia according to the number of prisoners and or killed persons in it is critically flawed as it ignores the individual value of every single victim and his or her relatives. Weighing human lives is out of the question. S21 was unique, and as the accused admitted yesterday for the first time, this prison was unique because it was the only prison in which high-level parties and members of the Standing Committee were delivered. But there are more reasons why S21 was unique. Its additional name was Special Branch. Its chairman worked closely together with the highest leaders of the regime, the Standing Committee, and under its direct supervision. Last but not least, it functioned most effectively on the highest level of operating with a high number of staff members with faultless efficiency under the iron hand of accused. Fifth, the National Defense Council is further completely misled if he believes that the accused cannot be prosecuted because he only obeyed orders. The applicable ACCC law clearly states in Article 29.4 the following, quote, the fact that a suspect acted pursuant to an order of the government of Democratic Cambodia or of a superior shall not relieve the suspect of individual criminal responsibility. Unquote. Thus, the defense statement that the accused is not guilty because he was only following the orders of his superiors does not exclude his guilt. This could be a mere mitigating factor, but never ever an exclusion of his guilt. As we have submitted in our closing statement, and the prosecution further elaborated on, and which we include by reference, the accused was a willing and enthusiastic participant, and not merely a victim of orders. Again, claiming that he was a victim of the regime is contemptuous and insults civil parties and the victims as a whole. Also, as the prosecution has properly demonstrated and proved in their submission, which we include by reference, the argument that the accused was under the threat of death and had no choice in his actions, that he was under duress, is not a successful one. The accused must be asked how he can now claim he is not guilty when he previously admits crimes were committed in S21 under his responsibility. The answer is that he wants to keep all doors open. Using this two-track policy could allow him to play the game to receive mitigating circumstances for his sentence in the case that the court would convict him, and at the same time he follows his truthful and real belief like he has always done in order to escape from criminal responsibility that only Ankar is liable. Going the easy way and shifting responsibility on the deaths and the faceless organization Ankar clearly shows that he is farther than ever from carrying the heavy burden of the enormous and horrendous crimes that he has committed. The use of his defense strategy confers an extremely bad example for other perpetrators and all Cambodians to escape from responsibility and does not contribute at all to the reconciliation process. On the contrary, civil parties who are seeking justice and truth are further alienated and more offended as the credibility of the accused is once again more eroded. To conclude, this defense strategy completely contradicts the accused's repeated assertion of having genuine remorse, and it leads to serious additional traumatisms for civil parties who listen for a long time to the accused's apologies and remorse and request for forgiveness. Again, as we submitted yesterday, his wish and demand to return to Cambodian society must be rejected. I thank you for your attention and give now the floor to my colleagues from Group 3.
Bonjour Monsieur le Président, Mesdames et Messieurs les juges. Je prendrai d'abord la parole quelques minutes pour le groupe des partis civils numéro 3, puis mon confrère Philippe Cannon me succédera. Monsieur Douch, vous avez eu la parole avant votre défense. Vous avez profité de ce temps d'expression directe devant, durant ce procès, de la publicité de cette audience de plaidoirie pour nous transmettre des informations techniques et historiques sur le fonctionnement du Parti communiste du Kampuchea démocratique. Mais, vous n'avez pas su avoir, nous n'avons pas entendu des paroles de profond repentir, d'excuses, de pardon et d'humanité vis-à-vis des victimes. Nous n'avons pas entendu, parce que vous n'avez pas prononcé des paroles exprimant une remise en cause fondamentale de la politique d'extermination d'ennemis imaginaires du régime politique auquel vous aviez adhéré avec enthousiasme et sans discernement. Monsieur Douch, vous n'êtes pas un bouc émissaire, parce que les faits qui vous sont reprochés sont malheureusement une réalité. Mais vous êtes un symbole. Et c'est à ce titre que les partis civils à la procédure, les victimes du régime des Khmer Rouges de tout le Cambodge, attendaient de vous autre chose que cette dénégation de responsabilité, vous conduisant à plaider des non-coupables et à demander au tribunal votre acquittement. Vous avez manqué de courage sur le régime des Khmer Rouges, vous n'avez pas su préserver les valeurs humaines fondamentales, comme le droit à la vie de tout individu. Et ici, devant cette juridiction, vous avez manqué de courage devant la justice, devant votre peuple et devant votre pays. Votre seul avocat a exprimé une émotion profonde, a rappelé vos aveux, votre participation à l'instruction, vos larmes lors des reconstitutions, évoquant à ce titre un grand moment d'humanité vraie. Mais vous ici, vous n'avez pas réitéré ces aveux. Vous n'avez pas demandé fondamentalement pardon. qu'attendait avant tout les parties civiles et les victimes. Vous n'avez pas su trouver le cœur des parties civiles et des victimes qui restent devant vous avec leur total désarroi. Je pense, Monsieur Duch, que vous avez manqué un rendez-vous que vous aviez avec l'histoire de votre pays et de votre peuple. De vos propres déclarations, on ne peut pas accepter les justifications de ce qui s'est passé à S21 des crimes et des tortures qui ont été commis au titre de la défense d'un régime politique. Lorsque vous avez vous-même dit 95% des détenus ne présentaient aucun risque pour le pouvoir politique. J'exprimais lundi que j'espérais qu'avoir après avoir entendu les parties civiles, vous les comprendriez peut-être. Je constate aujourd'hui qu'il n'en est rien. Vous vous excusez déjà des 12 000 ou des 16 000 morts dont vous avez été responsable Vous n'avez pas su prendre de distance avec un régime que l'on a justement appelé une utopie meurtrière. Aujourd'hui, M. Duch, vous êtes devant le tribunal, vous êtes seul, déjà vieux, et vous inspirez de la pitié. Vous aspirez aussi à cette pitié que vous n'avez jamais eue pour victime. En conséquence, aujourd'hui, le seul espoir des parties civiles et des victimes réside dans la décision que le tribunal prononcera, et ce sera de votre seul fait. C'est effectivement la nature et le quantum de la peine qui sera fixée, qui fixera la portée de votre responsabilité.
Je laisse la parole à
Monsieur le Président, Madame, Messieurs, il me reste 10 minutes, je serai donc très bref. J'ai entendu avec un grand intérêt la plaidoirie de Maître Roux. Nous avons bien compris à quelle hauteur de vue il entendait situer. Nous avons saisi l'humanisme qui conduit sa réflexion. Vous nous dites aujourd'hui, mon confrère, que c'est votre dernière plaidoirie que vous posez la robe. Vous savez, comme moi, que lorsqu'elle a été portée avec honneur et une robe d'avocat ne se dépose jamais. Nous savons qu'elle continuera de vous revêtir. Nous voulons, Monsieur le Président, Madame, Messieurs, dire à notre contradicteur combien nous aurions apprécié à sa juste valeur un véritable plaidoyer de culpabilité qui aurait permis de rechercher la vérité, quelle qu'elle soit, et de s'approcher du juge sans faute. Ce positionnement aurait constitué le bon dont j'avais voulu jeter les fondations lundi dernier. En regardant les parties civiles dans cette ultime confrontation,
messieurs
leur avaient redonné l'espace d'un instant leur statut d'êtres humains. En soutenant ce regard, les victimes avaient dépassé la haine et fixaient l'avenir. Depuis, le réquisitoire des coprocureurs a permis de dégager la portée de l'implication personnelle de la victime. Évidemment, nous avons entendu en filigrane le discours nuancé de Maître Roux sur la culpabilité. Évidemment, nous avons entendu que tout n'avait pas été énoncé par l'accusé. Je me rends compte, et je reprendrai en un instant ce que vient de dire Martine Jacquin, nous attendions de la part de Duc des mots de sincérité.
pas des excuses convenues, mais un véritable élan. Nous avons entendu où tout le monde va rentrer chez soi, retrouver la vie quotidienne, où l'on vient d'entendre requérir 40 ans de prison, tout pourrait être dit, où l'on pourrait ouvrir son cœur parce que l'émotion submerge.
C'est
consternant parce que l'on se dit que ce monsieur n'a rien compris. Qu'il est encore dans sa
méthode.
Là encore, on utilise ces fameux
bas
de page. Il est encore en plein dans le régime qu'il avait décidé de servir. Il est encore au milieu de la plus grande bureaucratie la plus absurde.
Là
où la réflexion, la raison, et la sensibilité ont été
l'allumé.
Et l'on est venu vous demander
l'attitement
avec
le
nécessaire corollaire de
l'irresponsabilité.
Il fallait oser.
On l'a fait. Votre
recours appréciera.
L'intérêt majeur
de cette juridiction internationale,
nous l'avons tous dit, est de permettre
la juxtaposition de cultures juridiques et judiciaires diverses et la construction d'un nouveau droit. Permettez-moi, Monsieur le Président, très rapidement de faire état d'une théorie qui existe en droit pénal français, plus exactement de trois théories qui coexistent. Ce que l'on appelle la théorie de l'obéissance passive, Maître Roux la connaît bien, qui conduit à justifier toutes les infractions commises sur
un
et aboutit à ce que tout commandement de l'autorité légitime soit un fait justificatif général. C'est la position adoptée par l'accusé. Celle dite des baïonnettes aux intelligents, c'est-à-dire la théorie où l'on dit que systématiquement il faut refuser un mauvais ordre. Et puis la théorie intermédiaire qui consiste à dire que on doit refuser un ordre illégal lorsqu'il est destructeur, abusivement cruel et que le subordonné réputé intelligent peut et même doit
refuser.
Nous considérons que ce qui permet d'être un homme, tout d'abord, c'est le pouvoir de dire non. Et quand l'espèce, l'intéressé, dispose d'une marge de manœuvre.
Enfin,
n'oublions pas que ce procès dont mon contracteur disait ce matin que nous construisons ensemble son exemplarité
est
regardé par la communauté internationale. L'on nous dit que dans d'autres enceintes judiciaires, on est déjà passé à autre chose. Et la leçon d'humanité donné dans le procès Obrémovitch est tout à fait admirable. Sauf que quelques différences notables, que dis-je, quelques abîmes nous séparent. 1. L'acquittement n'avait pas été
fait.
2. Il n'existait pas de partie. 3.
Obrenovitch avait conduit spontanément les enquêteurs auprès des Obrenovitch de ses prédécesseurs et n'avait pas pris la fuite. Quatre, les familles avaient été indemnisées.
Cinq,
le processus de réparation était élaboré. Ai-je entendu ici un seul instant une proposition en matière de réparation? Si je me contente d'écouter l'accusé, je me demande même si c'était
passé.
Vous avez repris, maître-vous, une proposition faite par l'une des parties civiles, Mme
Martin-Lefebvre,
qui proposait effectivement que Doug puisse, au sein du 1321, aujourd'hui, rendre service à la collectivité et prendre, par exemple, un emploi de cantonnier, oui, pas de guide. Cet honneur revient aux trois survivants, pas à tous.
Il s'agit de reconstruire cette histoire et de permettre aux parties civiles de se la réapproprier.
Il ne s'agit pas de réécrire l'histoire à sa manière. Comment voulez-vous, Monsieur le Président,
Madame, Messieurs,
que les parties civiles puissent entendre sans réagir, que 12 380 victimes à S21 représentent seulement
un
des exterminations. Puisque la défense a évoqué les enfants des sept survivants de M13, voulez-vous s'il vous plaît évoquer le sort des enfants des 12 000 morts?
Il
est, mon cher confrère, des pourcentages qui pèsent lourd sur le cœur des hommes et des femmes. Duc est mort, dites-vous. Le chagrin des parties civiles, lui, sera à perpétuité. Je vous remercie.
សូមអញ្ជើញលោកមេធាវីតំណាងដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋបាលពាណិជ្ជកម្ពុជាខ្ញុំបាទសូមអរគុណលោកប្រធានដោយពេលវេលាកាន់តែខ្លីពេកហើយខ្ញុំបាទសូមអនុញ្ញាតនិងសូមការអធិស្ឋានពីលោកប្រធានព្រោះក្នុងនាមខ្ញុំបាទជាមេធាវីដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋបាលពាណិជ្ជកម្ពុជាស្ដាប់ទៅគឺឈឺចាប់ណាស់វាចុកលឹះពីការពិតទៅទៀត មេធាវីបរទេសនិងលោកចៅក្រមលោកប្រជាញ្ញាបរទេសមិនធ្លាប់រស់ក្នុងរបបខ្មែរក្រហមមិនឈឺដូចយើងខ្ញុំទេស្ដាប់នៅការលើកឡើងរបស់លោកមេធាវីហ្វ្រង់សូរូនិងលោកមេធាវីកាសវុធជាផ្ទុយគ្នាជាមួយនឹងសម្ដីជនចាប់ចោតដែលសុំទទួលស្គាល់អំពើអក្រិតនៅក្នុងកណ្ដាប់ដៃនៃយន្តការសមភៃមួយ ទីនីតិក្រុមតាគួរជឿទេថាដូចមិនមែនជាអ្នកទទួលខុសត្រូវមួយដែលស្ថិតនៅក្នុងលំដាប់ខ្ពស់ជនរងគ្រោះទាំងអស់
ខ្ញុំអត់ក៏ជាជនក្នុងគ្រួសារមួយដែរខ្ញុំទុកចិត្តអត់បានទេបាទខ្ញុំបាទដឹងថាពេលវេលាខ្ញុំបាទមានតិចប៉ុន្តែខ្ញុំបាទសូមអនុញ្ញាតម្ដងហើយម្ដងទៀតថាខ្ញុំបាទទុកចិត្តមិនបានខ្ញុំបាទសូមពេលវេលាបន្តិចបន្ថែមហើយខ្ញុំបាទសូមឲ្យលោកប្រធាននិងអង្គជំនុំជម្រះមេត្តាទទួលយកនៅអ្វីដែលខ្ញុំបាទលើកឡើងនេះគឺខ្ញុំបាទនៅតែយល់ឃើញថាជឿថាគឺដូចឬជនចាប់ចោតឈ្មោះកាំងកាអ៊ីវហៅដូចជាអ្នកទទួលខុសត្រូវខ្ពស់នៅក្នុងមន្ទីរស-21ដែលបណ្ដាលឲ្យមនុស្សជាង 12,380 នាក់ឬលើសពីនោះបានស្លាប់យ៉ាងវេទនាយ៉ាងឈឺចាប់គ្មានថ្ងៃគ្មានពេលវេលាបំភ្លេចបានទេដូចគឺជាមនុស្សដ៏ល្អគឺមនុស្សដែលទទួលខុសត្រូវខ្ពស់ដែលបកឬក៏អង្គការជាពិសេសគឺសុនសេនដែលជាមេទាហានឬមេទ័ពនៅក្នុងប្រទេសកម្ពុជានៃរបបកម្ពុជាប្រជាធិបតេយ្យហើយក៏ជាមេនគរបាលមួយដែលមានអំណាចផ្ដាច់ផ្ដិលជីវិតរបស់ប្រជាពលរដ្ឋនៅពេលនោះដែរដូច្នេះអ្វីដែលជាខ្ញុំបាទចង់លើកឡើងគឺប្រៀបធៀបទៅនឹងម-13មកស-21មិនខុសគ្នាទេដូចបានថ្លែងពីម្សិលមិញហើយថារបៀបឬការសម្រេចនៃការកាប់សម្លាប់រង្គាលមានតាំងពីជំនាន់រំដោះមុនថ្ងៃ17មេសា1975ដូច្នេះអ្វីដែលដូចដឹងអ្វីដែលដូចមានបទពិសោធន៍គឺដូចត្រូវបានអង្គការឬបកជឿបកទុកចិត្តទទួលឲ្យដូចទៅធ្វើជាប្រធាននៅមន្ទីរស-21ទៀតព្រោះងាយស្រួលរបៀបស្វែងរកការធ្វើទោសការយកចម្លើយដែលមិនពិតដើម្បីយកមនុស្សទៅកំទេចចោលជាងសត្វដេរឆានទៅទៀតដូច្នេះដូចជានៅម-13កន្លែងឃុំឃាំងកន្លែងសួរចម្លើយមនុស្សគឺនៅនឹងអមលៀងកន្លែងកប់សាកសពឬសម្លាប់នៅត្រៃម្ខាងនៃស្ទឹងដែលដូចបាននិយាយហើយកន្លែងដែលដូចនិយាយថាជាកន្លែងធ្វើស្រែចម្ការគឺជាកន្លែងលត់ដំនៅម-13ខដូច្នេះនៅស-21គឺជាមន្ទីរឃុំឃាំងនឹងធ្វើទរណកម្មហើយកន្លែងដែលកាប់សម្លាប់គឺនៅបឹងជើងឯកឯកន្លែងដែលដូចនិយាយថាកន្លែងលោកដំឬក៏កន្លែងសមាជិកនៅព្រៃសរគឺវាមានសភាពដូចគ្នាអញ្ចឹងមុន17មេសា1975អ្វីដែលដូចធ្វើគឺដូចដឹងទាំងអស់ដូចចេះទាំងអស់របៀបសួរចម្លើយរបៀបចាប់ចងរបៀបធ្វើទៅរនកម្មរបៀបសម្លាប់គឺដូចជាបែបបាត់ហើយដូចបាននិយាយថាដូចមិនអាចគេចទៅណារួចទេនៅក្នុងរបបនោះដូចជានៅក្នុងចង្គំខ្លែឬក្នុងស្ពឺមួយគ្រាប់នៃម៉ាស៊ីនកំពុងដើរគឺគ្រាន់តែជាការដោះសារតែប៉ុណ្ណោះដូច្នេះត្រង់នេះហើយដែលថាដូចគឺជាអ្នកទទួលខុសត្រូវដូចមិនមែនជាអ្នកសម្រេចចាប់មនុស្សដូចមិនមែនជាអ្នកសម្រេចកំទេចមនុស្សប៉ុន្តែដូចជាអ្នកចាលើចំណាព្រោះមេមិនមែនមកពិនិត្យមើលដូចសពថ្ងៃនៅទួលស្លែងឬមន្ទីរស-21ទេដូចចាឲ្យអ្នកណារស់បានយូរគឺដូចចាបានដូចចង់ឲ្យអ្នកណាស្លាប់គឺដូចចាដាក់ថាដកឬកំទេចហើយមេក៏ធ្វើតាមដូច្នេះនៅក្នុងនេះនៅខ្ញុំបាទមានឯកសារតែដូចបានបដិសេធហើយនៅក្នុងលេខ D22/9 ឬ ERN0016 20649ដែលសរសេរចានៅក្នុងបានសម្រាប់ថ្ងៃ17ខែ2/7ឲ្យ1កំតិច115នាក់2ទុក23នាក់បូកនឹង21ស្មើនឹង44នាក់សមមុតដូចស្នើអង្គការឲ្យអង្គការយល់ព្រមអ្វីដែលដូចតែសេហើយដូចបាននិយាយថាក្រាន់តែជាលេសនៃការសរសេរអញ្ចឹងហើយចោះនៅពេលដែលគេចោតប្រកាន់ប្អូនថ្លៃដូចនឹងប្អូនមកកើតដូចអត់ធ្វើតាមទេមិនក៏គេមិនយកដូចទៅសម្លាប់ទៅហើយអ្នកដែលបាននៅរស់ទាំងនៅព្រៃសរទាំងនៅក្នុងទួលស្លាយស្រាប់ដែលនៅរស់មុននឹងដូចបាក់ទបឬក្រុមរបស់ខ្មែរក្រហមបាក់ទបទៅមិនមែនគេមានចេតនាចិត្តឈប់សម្លាប់មនុស្សឬបញ្ឈប់ការសម្លាប់ទេគឺពួកគេបាក់ទបពួកគេរត់ចោលស្រុកហើយគេបន្តយកអ្នកទោសដែលគេគិតថាគេនឹងសម្លាប់យកទៅជាមួយទៀតដោយភ្ជង់ទៀតមានអ្នកស្រីជុំនៅមានជុំមីមានប៊ូមេងដែលត្រូវបានគេភ្ជង់ហើយប្រពន្ធរបស់លោកជុំមីទៀតនឹងកូនត្រូវគេសម្លាប់នៅអមលៀងទៅទៀតនេះហើយឬដែលហៅថាចេតនារបស់គេចង់ជៀសឲ្យផុតអំពីអំពើប្រល័យពូជសាសន៍មនុស្សដូច្នេះខ្ញុំបាទសូមឲ្យលោកចក្រមមេត្តាពិចារណាឡើងវិញថាភាពឈឺចាប់នេះមានតែខ្មែរទេឬក៏ជនជាតិដែលនៅក្នុងរបបកម្ពុជាធិបតេយ្យផ្ទាល់ទេដែលឈឺដែលចុកចាប់ខ្លួនឯងដូច្នេះខ្ញុំបាទមិនមែនជាអ្នកសូមឲ្យផ្ដន់ទោសទេតែសូមឲ្យលោកព្រះរាជអាជ្ញានិងសហព្រះរាជអាជ្ញាសូមមេត្តារំលឹកឬក៏សូមពិចារណាឡើងវិញថាការស្នើសុំរបស់លោកត្រឹម40ឆ្នាំនោះគឺស្ទើរតែជាការសុំឲ្យជនរងគ្រោះដែលនៅរស់វាស្លាប់ទៅទៀតអញ្ចឹងសូមឲ្យពិចារណាឡើងវិញជាងខ្ញុំគិតថាអ្វីដែលដូចថ្លែងសូមទោសជាសាធារណៈនោះសូមឲ្យលោកចក្រមឬលោកប្រធានមេត្តាយកទទួលយកនៅពេលចាញ់សាក្រមឲ្យយកចម្លើយសារភាពឬសូមទោសរបស់ដូចដោយសូមឲ្យចាក់ផ្សាយតាមវិទ្យុជាតិ
trong đoạt tháp bị bao với cả sông ở thưa lúc sầm nạn đôi chỉ chiến đạo lúc thoát đại về nước nghi khôi khát tới bình sông Akun
tiền tiền đấy à gì bán vấn đề mình những cái lườn pì miền này tiền đấy mình những chàng ở ở dư đề nhé ở Pramon tiền bản thân địa miền ở bên trong này gì xong thì dây ơi dứt đâm bây ơi nè bộ prai phía xa nó ai bộ prai bàn bộ bộ prai sẽ đập nè bộ prai một toàn đấy.
Đó xong bà cô lục thiên chúng ta miên tại bản tích tiết tế lại xa nì cứ chiết tổ la ca khnát ăn trả chiết đằng khnát chiết dương mình rùm lốp sự thị mà nu dương mình ạ mà nu sự thoa dương mình ạ dứt tiết thoa đôi chả vây đại khang phía kì chôn chập tọa lực làng được tế bà sân chỉ dương chi mà nu ạ dứt tiết thoa nu mà lại xăm miền ẩm bơ hàng xa cả đàng hai để chứ này bộ dương khi chị đầm nang ở sông tô dương khi chị mê thử vị đầm nang ở đàm bản năng lập lý có xông lục bật thiên để chả nà thả bì bê lì từ mục tiết tu hấp đọc cho năm mà phây cho năm hà sắp mà rôi rưu bà rôi cho năm từ tiết cả đói đàm bây cầm ai bà chia rì hữu bà chia bà rôt tu hấp bọn bà ôn con trao dư vừa chôn của ma phlịch lăng cứ xông xông rùm lực hai rùm lực tiết thả chạ rụp đôi nâu khăn bần ti tu lạnh cho sẽ liệt bẹ khó áo khám áo bẹ sẽ bạch chương còn lán bong co cỏ ma nương bẹ mũ cần tập khám ai cỏ hôm chia ti rùm lực chia bê về liệt đà ni hai chia ổng bơ ạ mà nụ sử thoa nụ xùm ạ quần
và đây là ni cái ni tệ vị thi này cả phương đại sân thàn tòp rồi bò mấy tập viên đầm nàng đang mà đang gặp này chẳng buồn cấm đây tam phan ca cứ đòi pì về lìa ơi mùi mau ấy là đấy cứ bộ quạt bàn chầm này pì về lìa xong trộp cứ buồn mau tam ở với đây ông chầm đây bàn bài chạy ấy hơi khuyên tha đòi tìm chọn hơi hay ấy là đấy đòi pì từ chụp tầm ra đòi pì lưng nghệ hơi ông chầm đây cả ạ đầm nào cả thảm nào cả thảm rập ngày đi trầm đi hơi thảm nào cả năng lượng từ bản to thôi đời ngày sai ngày tìm một phần bớt hay bị cha bị sẽ cai cho năm bị bòn bầm bún cha bị màu bầm bún bực tử hay ông nhầm đấy có xôm nhầm điệp phòng đáy thà phía kia năng sản sinh lại chốn thà nập bực ngày sai đi ông nhầm đấy năng đào vị thị ca ao từ thà về nhá làm thôi để sanh than to rồi mình tổ mộc ông nhầm đấy nâng đòi bị ca ở từ chập chao nâng thạ mình từ bị ca bị cái đấy là anh phơi để thân thân to trong còi mong ở hai đứa chân sum phía kia nâng sát chân đại chân chìa nâng chân châu rùm được không sợ mặt cá ban môn pì cầm nọt anh rồi đấy mình thì không khéng ở nòm chân chập chao tất cả mình thì không khéng với nhau ở nòm quạt một căn sát sát mặt cá được bậc ngày say ở ban môn mong làm buôn chia cầm hận
xong trên cầu trường.